Does this class model appeal to you? Or does it consist of too many types for what it communicates? Would you like it better this way? It is surely fewer types this time. But how can I ask you to tell me which model is better before providing the information? I will show you the tools we use to design a good model for a given project. I will also share with you more learning resources at the sponsor of this video, Brilliant. Now let me start by giving you the numbers. Numbers do not lie. Let's start with the most useless code metric of all time. Counting lines of code. While lines of code are of little use in project management and planning, they still remain a fact of life. You do write code, don't you? Here is how a project grows over time. It would invariably start fast. We set up infrastructure and scaffolding first, much of which is generated code anyway. Things will become more engaging later. You will naturally slow down after the initial rush as there is more to think about now. That is where the proper distinction between good and bad code begins to show up. A well-designed model would converge to a speed at which the team can continue developing endlessly, often longer than a decade. A poorly managed project would grind to a halt. What is the difference between these two when you open and read the code? A well-developed project would exhibit problem decomposition, separation of concerns, and other traits of good organization. Any code duplication you might encounter would be of a very consciously controlled kind. The code will enjoy well-balanced abstractions, not too many, not too little. If anything, this is where I would hope to find simple code. Projects that do not enjoy the benefits of these practices will mature the way working animals do. Observe how I am not showing you any code or designs yet. I still speak of the effort to develop a project, something like 10 people, 1 year, 100,000 lines of executable code. So far, I have only measured things from a distance. It is the sheer amount of work I'm thinking of. Now I ask, can you make a simple code in that? I feel it is important to mention what kind of a project this might be. I mostly speak about business applications on this channel, for a reason. If you are, by a chance, a game developer, then your primary worry is probably whether all the calculations will end by the next video frame. You might also worry about allocations or battery life. Frequent garbage collection might be an issue. It goes along the same lines in embedded systems. Saving battery or limiting memory consumption comes to mind. However, these are rarely of any concern in business software. Availability, money calculations, utility, legislation, reports. Those are the worries of a programmer in business software development. Still, the most apparent distinction between business applications and any others is in their size. Business domain applications are huge. Forget about a bird flapping on a smartphone. Meet me at an airline software developer's desk. Or in an oil company or a civil engineering company. In this video, I search for simple code in a project of substantial size. Where can I find it? There are a few aspects that affect the answer. Coding and modeling styles can play a role. The object-oriented approach is the dominant style today. If a procedural style were applied, it would invariably inflate both the project's size and duration. A functional approach would easily cut the code to half, possibly more. However, the development time would not follow exactly. There is still a lot of planning and testing to do, irrespective of the coding style. This shows why just counting lines is futile. It does not tell us what we need to know. Not even development time does. We must read the code to assess how complex it is. There is another angle of view when working with complex domains. Persistence. Take a relational database and count how many tables there are. 10 people working for a year sounds like hundreds of database tables. I'm telling that from my past experience. In corresponding document storage, there would be hundreds of node types which would end up equally complex. Load those nodes or tables into code, and there you will find at least 1,000 types to support them, be it procedural structs, object-oriented classes, or functional types. Now comes the critical question. I often hear programmers blame types for their project's complexity. It sounds almost as if they would be happy to see fewer types. Let's run a thought experiment. Instead of 1,000 classes, squeeze the project into 100. As a consequence, the classes would average 1,000 lines each. The most important ones would be thousands of lines long. Simple code does not live in projects with a small number of types. If you need simplicity, you will increase the number of classes and types instead. Their numbers will grow at the expense of making each of them shorter. Let me show you how that works on this example class model. It comes from the demo bookstore application, which you can find me developing in other videos on my channel. The books and authors are all we care to work with. Two classes will suffice, right? Don't jump to conclusions. Wait until you hear the requirements. The customer will be adding new requirements for months, if not years. There will be hundreds of individual features before this project matures. Each feature requires code. If I kept adding more code into the limited number of classes, they would quickly become unmanageable. Fast forward a couple of weeks. The customer has asked for an editable list of authors. It turned out there are a dozen ways to do that. I literally had to introduce an intermediary class that only manages authors. Even then, I had to move a larger half of that code into the list extension class. It was the separation of concerns that drove this design. The book used to manage the core concepts. An author kept its own core responsibilities too. The list of authors, however, became a concept in its own right. Still, the list part and the author's part ended up separate. The customer kept going with the book's release definition. I extracted a release class and started nourishing more code there. Pulling out the specifics of the book's edition was the subsequent request. There are quite a few new methods that operate on the edition. The publishing date popped out as an absolute nightmare. Books vary in precision when telling the day they were published, and it only got worse when the customer asked to account with future releases. That request broke the entire model. What do you think about this model now? Would you revert it to a two-class model? Let's squeeze the object model a bit and see what happens. The requirements stay, of course. That is what many programmers just forget. You cannot remove classes or types from a project without also removing their associated features. Now some other class must take over those features, quickly growing beyond any possibility of maintaining them later. I can make the book's edition recede into the release class, but only at the expense of enlarging it. The edition variants carry their methods along. How about retracting the entire release class back into the book class? The list of authors follows. And voila! There it is, the book class with 100 methods and a 4-digit length already. And we are only a few sprints into the project. This design is obviously a bad one. If you were looking for simple code, it's not here. The first step towards simple code is to make the individual types shorter. Apply good naming schemes, let every item you pass the control on to have a good explanatory name, favor declarative naming over imperative. You will feel better as you start accepting that coding style. Where will the simplicity be then? A single line method could take an hour to understand if you insist on fully understanding it. A method well done would avoid mixing the intrinsic complexity of the problem domain with the added complexity of the programming language or design method. As a programmer, you ought to do this part well. Try to attain a good separation of concerns with an excellent naming scheme. Succeed in that, and you will succeed in everything else. This code is not simple. This line of code is, but the overall code is not. There could be 1,000 lines of code that only make this one line possible, and hundreds of lines of code that effectively execute when this one line runs. The simplicity is in training your mind to not try to see all those hundreds and thousands of lines of code at once. Focus on a tiny portion of the problem instead. That will let you ponder over only a few lines of code at any given moment. Here's the golden rule. You can control anything at once. You can control everything, no matter how large the project is, but you cannot control everything at once. That just won't fit your head. The simplicity is in letting go of the urge to control everything all at once. Complexity will stay, only this time bounded into its own little boxes, each dealing with one concept only, adding one feature only. From all I know, that is your only chance to attain simple code in a complex project. It requires a lot of knowledge and thinking out of the box. Speaking of which, there is a lot you can learn if you visit the sponsor of this video, Brilliant. I suggest you take their course on how LLMs work. It is informative and leads you through the interactive learning process. Brilliant recently launched a ton of new data science content, all of which uses real-world data to train you. You will find thousands of interactive lessons in math, data analysis, programming, and AI. Brilliant provides deep learning in specific areas of programming, engineering, and science. Whatever area you choose, Brilliant helps build your critical thinking skills through problem solving. There is a full 30-day free of charge offer for you. Follow the link brilliant.org/Zoran Horvat, scan the QR code, or just click the link in the description. That will also give you a 20% discount on an annual subscription after the trial period, so please make sure to use this link to unlock the benefits. Also, watch the coding demos on my channel that show how you can bake these abstract techniques into concrete lines of code.